amazing. It's giving me goosebumps. You're giving me goosebumps that there's this many people who care deeply about public education in the state of New York, and actually in the country and in the world. It is the great equalizer. So I see people still filling in. There are seats up here. There are seats over there. There's a couple seats over here. But come on in as quickly as you can and get seated. I see there's children in the audience. One of our panelists is a middle school student. We need to get her home. So please come on down. We'll start in about 2 minutes. Thank you. Gentlemen, can I have your attention, please? Thanks again for the energy. We really would like to get started. As a teacher in Geneva, I'd like to give everybody a 30-second warning. So this is your 30-second warning, and we're about to get started.
Good evening, everyone. If we could, if I could just bring us together. That's good. Okay. You're very kind to bring us together like that and give me an applause at the same time. My name is Mark Gearan, and I'm the president of Hobart and William Smith Colleges, and we warmly welcome you to our campus. Welcome. I am happy to welcome you to our campus. I know there are some of our graduates here in the room. Welcome back. That's good. I know many of you have continued your education and go on to lives of consequences as educators, so we welcome you back here. But I also welcome you to campus as the son of a high school principal in Massachusetts, as the son of an elected school board member, as the brother of both of my siblings who worked their entire careers in public education, as well as my brother-in-law. So I welcome you here as someone who has enormous respect for teachers and for public education. I also welcome you here as a parent, grateful for the Geneva City School District. When we moved to Geneva, our daughter, eldest daughter, started first grade, went all through the system, and is now a senior in college, and a high school sophomore. So I know public education. I know public education in the Geneva School District. With my wife, Mary, and I, we know the quality and the dedication of teachers here in Geneva and the region. And so we warmly welcome you in all those capacities here. I'm also impressed with your civic engagement here. As someone who, right in front of my house, the civic engagement. We've had other kinds of civic engagement as a college campus. Much younger than all of you. But a cheap shot, I know. Things are going so well here. But I, as someone who has thought a lot about civic engagement in the academic context for our undergraduates and who has written about it, I applaud that in the modeling of civic engagement that you bring to a discussion of this forum and these issues. I'm sure there can be a spectrum of views, and a forum like this allows the opportunity for all of us to get a better sense. And that is one of the key things that I've been working on here at Hobart and William Smith with our students, is the nature of civic engagement. And a few years ago, I brought as our convocation speaker Congressman John Lewis. And on the 50th anniversary of Selma, he's recalled to many of us because, of course, he crossed that bridge and was beaten senselessly, and has gone on to serve with distinguished career in the Congress. But when Congressman John Lewis came to our campus at convocation, he urged of our students a sentence that it stays with me, that I remind our students about in terms of issues of our day and the importance of civic engagement. And what he said at our convocation, and to urge our students, is to find a way to get in the way. Find a way to get in the way. And for all of us that care about issues, that care about civic engagement, and the importance of the public sphere, his life's journey gives testament to that, and standing for that reflection. And in thinking about your own public engagement, I honor that as well. One of the ways that we find a way to get in the way here in Geneva is our work with the City School District in Geneva 2020, a partnership with the business community, the not-for-profit sector, the faith community, in modeling a collective impact of how we can all be a part of a great city school district with great aspirations and great leadership and great teachers to make it an even better one. And that's what we've seen evolving over the past 3 or 4 years. So Geneva 2020 is our way to work in partnership with the business community, citizens, retired citizens, the faith community, nonprofits, to advance the strategic priorities of the Geneva School District. And I think its recognition as a District of Distinction, most recently noted, affirms that progress, affirms the aspiration that the leadership has in our partnership with them. So on this day, in this interesting conversation that's about to unfold, we welcome you to our campus, and I commend the kind of engagement and the spirit of working together to advance the ideals that we all have for our students. Welcome to campus.
Good evening. My name is Joy Martin, and I am a public educator. I also happen to teach in the Geneva City School District. I'm a literacy coach, and I'm the union president. And I came here because I know a bunch of people who are passionate about education, and I wanted them all to come and share their views with you as a way for you to then go and turn out and, as Mark said, Congressman Lewis said, find a way to get in the way to help move our agenda forward. And in order to set the stage tonight, we have asked Dr. Steve Uebbing to come and give us just a little bit of a chat about the global perspective about what's going on with education. Steve Uebbing was first to come to my attention as the Canandaigua superintendent, and he was there for 17 years, I believe. And then I took Canandaigua. Yeah, it's Canandaigua's in the room. But he inspired me when I took an education law class from him as part of my administrative classes that I took when I was thinking that I might become a public school administrator. I decided to stay a teacher and worked with Dr. Uebbing as he helped the Geneva City School District start to make their way with a strategic plan after we had the state come in and give us a review saying, you need to do some work. And Dr. Uebbing helped us do some work, and as you've heard, we've just been recognized as the District of Distinction, and all of the other schools that are around here are doing amazing things for children. And so Dr. Uebbing tonight is going to just help us set the stage for our conversation, and then you'll hear from a number of different people from community schools and what they see its challenges as we move forward. So, Dr. Uebbing.
Is this work? This work? I actually do better with a standing mic. Hey, everybody, how you doing? That was really cool watching that demonstration. I thought we'd be back in the 60s when I went to college. Yeah. Of course, we would have been much rowdier. The cops would have been arresting a few of us. But, you know, it brought back some fond memories. You're doing great work. You know, Geneva is a wonderful school district. And here's the paradox. Geneva's a wonderful school district, people doing great work. You know, I was part of a review at North Street, so saw some great things. But the kids in Geneva come with certain challenges that are gonna translate into classroom challenges that aren't gonna be reflected in high scores on what I call the Pearson tests. Everybody know what the Pearson tests are? Did it work yet? Now, right now, I'm a superintendent again. I'm the superintendent of East High School. And we took that as a voluntary effort, the University of Rochester, in one of the most troubled and challenged schools in the Rochester area, 42% graduation rate. And our kids come with extreme challenges. 78% of our children entering seventh grade are on level one reading. And we have teachers doing great work. We're going to help them do even better work. But the issues of urban education, the issues that kids walk in the door with, you know, a kid who grows up in extreme poverty, and this is not, you know, the Hart-Riesling study found that a kid who grows up in extreme poverty has heard about 30 million less words than a kid who grows up in an upper middle class home by the time he gets to kindergarten. And the vocabulary development that child walks in the door with is going to be reflected the first time that child takes a test in third grade. And he's not going to catch up to the wonderful kids in Penfield. You see, I use Penfield, great district, great community, no criticism. But out my back door at East now, okay, I can go 3.5 miles to be at Penfield High School. And the difference is stark. Wonderful community, my daughter lives there, and our kids growing up in East have totally different challenges than the kids in Penfield. So is this working? Oh, this is good. I like this. So I'm going to take you through a little PowerPoint. I promise it won't be too long. Is there a clock here. The better speaker than me coming up, Mike Nozzolio's here, and I'll introduce him. But he has a pressing schedule, so I can't be too long. But what's wrong with that picture? And what does that have to do with the educational picture in New York State today? Well, the governor wrote a letter. Governor wrote a letter to the Board of Regents back in the fall. We kicked off this whole debate. And he said, "Dear Regents, please explain to me why APPR appraisals of teachers are overwhelmingly effective or highly effective while student scores on the New York State testing program have gone down. Signed, the Gov." So as a backdrop to my presentation, we're going to start with that letter from the governor to the Board of Regents. I'll come back to it at the end, okay? But let's go back to the testing situation. I'm not anti-testing per se, but let me tell you what good testing does. Good testing informs good instruction. So assessments should lead to diagnosis and prescription so that good teachers can look at what little Johnny did and say, "My goodness, he doesn't understand inference yet. We have to work on inference." And then teachers collaboratively can plan, how are we going to deal with the fact that Johnny doesn't understand inference? I got an idea. This works for me. Why don't we try that? But in this state, the tests are under lock and key. I think you can go to federal prison if you look at them. Okay? and they're not used for anything other than accountability. Because the assumption is that if a teacher is effective, the kids do well on a test. I don't care if, like one of my students who's now graduated, told me that he has to use two hands to count all of his friends who've been killed by gunshot. If he's not reading at level 3, the school has failed. Doesn't matter what the background is, doesn't matter what the challenges are, doesn't matter the fact that we have 24% of our kids are students for whom English is not their first language. You still have to make the grade. Because the tests are not about education. They're not about diagnosis, prescription. They're not about pedagogy. They are about accountability. That's what we use tests for. Think about that. Is that the purpose of assessment? You all went to teacher school, right? How many went to teacher school? Raise your hand. Didn't you get taught? Didn't they teach you the tests are about assessment? So not that long ago, you know, we used to have the most respected testing system in the country, the good old Regents. They were rigorous, and some kids did well, and some kids didn't. We prepared for them. We didn't have a K-8 testing program forever, but we did back in the 80s and the 90s, and it got refined and improved. And in the mid-90s, people thought we had the best K-8 testing program in the country. But there came a point where somebody looked at it, when Rick Mills was done being commissioner, his predecessor looked at it and said, you know, there's a problem with the performance on New York State tests. Kids are doing better than we would have anticipated. And we could tell they're doing better because they're not doing as well on the NAEP test, the National Assessment of Educational Progress, as they are on the state test. So it must be the state test's cut points are too high, or too low rather, so we'll raise them. Now that's a different debate. I'm not going to go there. But all of a sudden, a lot of kids who are fours or threes and threes or twos, same test, same learning standards, continued on. By 1911, with 60% of kids being proficient, by the way, you have to understand what proficient is. Everybody should go home and look up proficient. Most of you are not proficient in parallel parking. Okay? Proficient is like an A-, B+. Okay, how many, be honest with you, how many go around the block to avoid parallel parking? Right? Look at all that. Okay, so proficiency is a pretty high level. But we had about 60% of kids proficient. We changed the cut point because of the NAEP test. But there was still an alignment between instruction, this is critical, instruction, curriculum, assessment, and the standards. They weren't perfectly aligned, but they were aligned. See, that's what good teaching, good testing, and good assessment is. The learning target's known, the trajectory towards learning target's known, and there's an exact alignment between what the teacher's teaching and what the kid's supposed to be learning. 2013, we introduced the Common Core State Standards. Now, I'm not going to do an anti or pro Common Core thing, but the new Pearson test, commercially made, because we don't trust teachers to make the test, what would you know? They're rolled out, and there's no clear-cut alignment between curriculum, instruction, assessment, and standards. You see, teachers are out there, they get the the modules, and they say, this must be the curriculum. But it's not. It's not. The modules aren't curriculum. And the standards, kind of nationally and statewide, Pearson makes the tests in secret. I've actually been part of some of those tests on the administrative test, and that's a different session. Meanwhile, there's an assessment made by, there's the standards and the assessment aren't made by the same people, you see? So there's four different ideas out there, teacher being one with instruction. What does the curriculum really look like? Is there a state curriculum? I don't think so, but maybe there is. Is this the state curriculum, the modules, or not? The test being made in Massachusetts by Pearson, and the standards actually coming out on a national basis, and the lack of alignment and the lack of preparation, and the fact that, you know, I don't want to go to jail for this, but I've seen some of those tests. and the questionable nature of the tests themselves, my theory is the reason those tests aren't public is because they couldn't survive scrutiny. But that's my theory. But now, on the new test, we plummet below our performance on the NAEP. We're actually doing better on the NAEP in the state than we are on the new Common Core state standards. And the governor wants to know, how come APPR says one thing and the state tests say another? I think the answer is more obvious than he wants to realize. Despite the fact that we contain some of the best schools in the world, okay? And oh, by the way, we have the most segregated public school system in the country. I walk through my halls at East High School, and I walk through Geneva, I walk through Canandaigua, I walk through other schools. We have one of the most segregated school systems in our country. We've organized our schools based only on your parents' income, based on where they can afford to live. And here's, you can do this blindfold. Take a state test, take free reduced lunch out, and you've got your curve right there. Absolutely predictive. Oh, there'll be some variation, okay? And the problem is, it's not a problem, the challenge is, kids from poor families need more help, you see? And we were doing that. We really were doing that in the 90s and past the turn of the centuries. You know, where have all the reading teachers gone? You know, I can remember AIS meant AIS. You see, AIS meant real people who were specialists in reading and mathematics helping kids. And we've watered down the supports we give to kids, ESL kids, AIS kids. And as a result, you know, I'll be the first one to say we're not doing as well as we could if we had the level of support and the interventions that kids desperately need. East High School, seventh grade, 78% of the kids enter at level one in reading. Not one reading teacher at East High School. Not one reading teacher. But in the suburban schools, my friend, I think Webster has 42 reading teachers, you know, K-12, because they are not affected as much by the variations in state aid and so forth. So the governor seems to think the whole system, the whole educational system needs to be ripped up. Kind of like, you remember the picture of the lawn? You know, can you look out, we have time to rip up the lawn and start anew. See, he sees our lawn, his education lawn, like this. Kind of looks like mine. And he wants it to look like this. So I want you to play a little game. If your lawn was this one, and your neighbor's lawn was that one, your lawn, neighbor's lawn, okay, there you are together. And you wanted your lawn to look like your neighbor's lawn. You think maybe you'd try to see what your neighbor was doing and maybe copy them a little bit? Oh, you got to water it. Oh, I see, yeah. Yeah, go get that water out here. So who's our neighbor? Who's our closest neighbor? Well, actually, our closest neighbor is Canada. And Canada is one of the highest performing school systems in the world. And the reason I picked Canada, why didn't you pick Finland? Yeah, the Finns are great, but their culture is not a lot like ours. You know, the whole way of doing that. Well, why didn't you pick Shanghai or South Korea? Because it's a different approach to life. But the Canadians, they really kind of a lot like us, you know? If you look at Canada, Ontario, okay, versus New York, you know, we have 21.2% living on poverty, which is a travesty, but they have almost 14%. 26% of their adults have bachelor's degrees, 13 percent of dropouts in UCRs are pretty close, 32 and 13. We have a lot more people. They have a huge metropolitan area, Toronto, where we all like to go, okay, have a good time. We have a huge metropolitan area, the greatest city in the world, New York City, where I was born, in Brooklyn, New York. Thank you very much. Hey, who's from Brooklyn here? Come on. Always somebody from Brooklyn. Yeah, give it up for Brooklyn. I went to Sheepshead Bay High School in Brooklyn. That's now closed down. I was born at Unity Hospital in Brooklyn. That's now, they now dissembled that. There's no record of me ever being there. So, back to 2009, and look at the PISA. This is the international test. PISA results. Canada was, we were 14th overall. Remember, 2009, because I'm going to go to 2012 in a second. Raw scores of 500, 501, 508. That's reading, math, and science. Look how good Canada did, okay? Really did well, 524. They were third in the world that year, 534 and 538. You know, the top five are South Korea, Finland, Canada, New Zealand, Japan. Interestingly, UK was 20th, and a lot of stuff that we're doing in this country is copying the UK, just so you know that. So so you might want to say, gee, you guys are doing pretty well. I wonder if we could learn from the Canadians, from guys like Michael Fullan. In 2012, everybody went down. What happened between 2009 and 2012? The recession. And what happened in most schools, cuts were made, you know, classroom size was tried to kept intact, the basic educational program was kept intact. But you look at most schools, the cuts impacted ESL, reading, AIS. So those who else?
Counseling,
social workers. So you look at the peripheral kid, the kids on the border, okay? The kids who, if I can just get a little more help, if my class size can just be a little smaller, if I can just have a few more kids, I can probably not be classified. I can probably be successful. You know, our goal in ESA sounds pretty modest, is to get kids to level two. Because a level two kid can do grade level work, you know? If I can just get to level two, you know? A lot can happen if we just move them up there. When I was in Canandaigua, it wasn't me, it was the community, it was the system. We had, I tried to count them all. We probably had about 22 reading teachers district-wide. You know, and they're restoring those now, by the way. And I can see Canandaigua moving back towards a more focused intervention level. But all over the state, those positions were cut, and the AIS positions were cut, and the positions that make a difference for the marginal kids, the kids who can go one way or the other, were cut, and a lot of those kids went the other way. And scores went down internationally, scores went down in New York State, and that's the impact of changes, not just in funding, but changes in focus, okay? Let's compare a little more about Canada and the United States. In both countries, schools are heavily unionized. They both, you know, teachers are reasonably well paid. I know you could argue about that, but reasonably well paid with good job security and benefits. In Canada, though, I just did some work on this last week. Teachers have a much higher level of respect than they do in the United States. There's no teacher bashing that I could find in the Canadian newspapers. And when I talked to one of my students who grew up in Canada, he said, no, our teachers are looked upon as people of great importance in Canada. In Finland, teachers are like doctors and lawyers, you know? So, and here there seems to be desire to just beat up your local classroom teacher for some reason. In Canada, there's a strong commitment to equity for all population groups. The achievement gaps are smaller. They really work. If school does poorly, they try to support them. Better basic services for students and families, much smaller differences in funding levels from one district to another. More consistency across school districts and districts, schools and districts and curriculum teaching methods. You know, one of the things that I don't think is a great strength is everybody gets to make it up. That's not going to work. You know, we're not independent contractors. We got to all embrace best practice, but we got to do it together. It's not something we can impose on people. We have to work together, discover what works well for our kids, and embrace those practices. In Canada, when teachers struggle, it's seen as a school-wide issue, and people rally around to help that teacher succeed, as opposed to this country where we're really more of isolationists, and it's more of a collective practice in Canada than it is here. Teachers are not made scapegoats in Canada. Here, teachers seem to be the scapegoat for everything wrong with public education. Education is a cooperative experience, not a competitive experience. But here's the one I really like.
Testing differences. In New York, we give two tests every year, 3, 5, 6, 7, and 3, 4, and 8, 5 regions exams, and students spend up to 50 hours a year in testing. In Ontario, there are 4 mandatory assessments from K through 12. 4 mandatory tests every student takes from kindergarten through 12th grade. That's a pretty significant difference. Students spend about 6 hours every 3 years. In this country, our tests are not specifically aligned to a state curriculum. In Ontario, not Ontario County now, Ontario, Canada, there is a provincial curriculum, and the assessments are 100% based on the Ontario curriculum. So if you're out in the classroom someplace, you know exactly what the learning target is and how to align curriculum instruction, assessment, and standards. In New York, tests are often developed by commercial testing companies that certainly the regions used to be developed locally, but now they're moving to some commercial tests there. That's true. Am I right on that? And in Ontario, tests are created by qualified teachers with help from international testing experts. So it's the teacher-driven curriculum and test based on standards that make sense, and we know, and the actual instruction is aligned to those standards. So remember this again, in a fully developed high-performing system, curriculum, instruction, assessment, and standards are aligned. Memorize that. We do it in choral reading. Am I do it? Ready? Everybody do this with me. Say this with me. In a fully developed, high-performing system, curriculum, instruction, assessment, and standards are aligned. Okay, that's what we're going for. In New York, we have high school multiple statewide tests are graduation requirements. Not that way in Canada. There's a math assessment in ninth grade, but it's not a graduation requirement. And the 10th grade assessment is not the only way to get to graduation. The cost of statewide standardized testing in the United States can be as high as $105 per student. In Canada, they're spending about $17 per student. So there's a budget gap, man. We found it. Call the gov. We got it. This is a little dense, but I just want you to read the first paragraph. This is from, actually, lesson from PISA for the United States, 2012. See that at the bottom? Lessons from PISA for the United States. I'll only read the first paragraph. When performance data in the United States are often used purely for purely accountability purposes, other countries tend to give greater weight to using them to guide intervention, reveal best practice, and identify shared problems. Where school performance is systematically assessed, the primary purpose is often not to support an evaluation of public services or to support market mechanisms and the allocation of resources, rather it is to reveal best practices and identify common problems in order to encourage teachers and schools to develop more supportive and productive learning environments. That's a good use of testing. You see, that's what we should be doing in testing. So we should go into our neighbors and ask them, geez, how come you're doing so well on these international tests? What do? We organize schools based on the economic status of their parents. My student in my class told me he lived in public housing, but he sat next to his pediatrician's daughter in class. We commit malpractice and assessment design use. We systematically defund public schools while funding private options. We blame the hardest working people on earth for our problems. I am the husband of a classroom teacher. I am the father of an ESL teacher. I am the father of a ninth grade social studies teacher. And I know what they do every single weekend. I know what happens in their lives every single day, the challenges they bring home, how deeply they care about what happens, and how they struggle to try to provide the highest quality education they can for the kids they serve. And then we want to withhold funding from what is really the center of our communities. See, we're not just talking about Long Island, great place, not anti-Long Island, or Brooklyn, or Queens. You see, the governor doesn't realize, as Mike Nozzolio does, by the way, that in upstate New York, the local public school system is the heart of that community. You know, You go to Palmyra, Mass. On a Friday night in Palmyra, all they want to do is talk about the football game. this time of year at Midlakes, they just want to talk about the great musical they're going to do. Any candidate. You go to any one of our communities, you go to Canada and Victor during football season for a big game, you know, and the kids grow up with this sense of belonging and culture and being part of something. It's such a wonderful thing. Diane Ravish, everybody should read her book, talks about the attraction and the center attraction of the local public school. It's the same in the cities, actually. And if we don't have that, and by all means, held to very high standards for all of us, if we don't have that, we lose something that is really part of the essence of the American culture. So my explanation to the Gov is, dear Gov, because the New York State testing system is not actually aligned to any established curriculum, may not be aligned to the Common Core State Standards, and is not used to guide instructional improvement. And that's why your lawn looks the way it does. So, I was blessed to be the superintendent of schools in Canada for 18 years. And it just was the best place to be a superintendent. I had a wonderful board, incredible teachers, wonderful staff. During that time, like all my superintendent buddies, I was very politically active. And I came to realize that the stabilizing force in state government was the upstate Republican caucus. Now, I'm a Democrat. I'm a lifelong Democrat. I'm about to switch because I'm so convinced that we elected the Tea Party into the Albany, into the Capitol as governor. And there's always been this group of senators who really understood what places like Seneca Falls and Waterloo and Geneva really were like, and what the people in those communities really valued and what they really would benefit from. And one of my friends, and I think one of the leaders of that caucus, clearly one of the leaders, but really one of the great spokespeople for rationality, for logic, and for process is, well, one of the leaders of the New York State Senate, Mike Nozzolio. So Mike came right from Albany to be here. He's going to say a few words, and he's going to be pulled out for something, but he's always here for us. And again, thank you, Mike.
Steve, thank you. Let's give Steve another round of applause. What a great job, Steve. Thank you. Wonderful. I always enjoy listening to Steve, and good night, good evening, everybody. I'm here thanks to Governor Cuomo. No, really. That we're negotiating the budget in 10 days. The legislature needs to convene and vote on a final product. We had two budget conference committee meetings today. I was chair of one, I'm a member of another, and we were supposed to, half a dozen of us senators were supposed to have a meeting with Governor Cuomo later in the day. That's why, Joy, thank you for inviting me. I wasn't sure up until 3:30 this afternoon that I could come here today, and I thank you for the invitation. Governor Cuomo had that meeting and he canceled. So I said, I'm on my way to Geneva. And thank you, Steve, for those enlightening and very kind comments as well. I want to give a shout out to a longtime friend, a family friend. His mom even baked our wedding cake. It was a great cake. It worked, too. I'm still married. We're still married. But I want to give a shout out to a young man who dedicated himself to education. He was a former intern in my office. Now he's involved with our teacher organizations, Jeff Trout. Jeff, thank you very, very much. Great job. Great job. Jeff. Mark Gearan, so well connected things. And I know many of you here, those who don't know me, I'm Mike Nozzolio. I represent the 54th Senatorial District. I'm born and raised in Seneca Falls. I'm very proud of the fact that I am a New York State Senator, but remembering every single day that I would not be in this position if I did not have the influence of many wonderful teachers through my educational process it's Seneca Falls schools. My mom never got through high school. She regretted that her entire life. And so education was an extreme priority in my family. My dad, an immigrant from Italy, never got to high school because of language, being an immigrant, had economic conditions in the Great Depression to work and feed his family. But they had one objective, and that's to send their three boys to college. My younger brother and I went to Cornell University. My older brother was the black sheep. He went to Columbia. But he's the one that became a school board president for many years. And his wife was a teacher. And not just a teacher. My sister-in-law was a special ed teacher. And it was a mixed marriage from the get-go. Not because of the teacher school board, but because he was an Italian from Seneca Falls. She was an Irish lady from Waterloo. So that was really... That was really contentious. Are any of my other colleagues here state legislators? Okay, I know I can speak for, I don't speak for anyone but myself, but I know Tom O'Mara, who represents Yates County, is working hard with us. And what are we working hard on? Let me just give a quick laundry list and then open this up to any questions if Joy thinks there's time. First and foremost, we have been dedicated to filling the crater in education financing and funding created by the GEA. We want to fill that hole and do it this year. We've been working on it. We're not late to the party. We've been trying to do this for a number of years. But now is the time. We have the appropriate funds available, that there are legal settlements from big court cases that we think should be used to establish the number one priority we should have, and that's our education funding. That's number one. Number two, we should not hold hostage the state budget for a potpourri of listings that the governor suggests should be established regarding the structure of testing and evaluation, regarding using tests, and Steve, what a great job you did, of showing tests and evaluations. I'll never forget, senior in high school, forget my digression, please forgive my digression. Senior in high school, teacher, was a great teacher, nice guy. I asked him a question. He said, Mr. Nozzolio, this isn't on the Regents. We don't have time to go over it. And I thought, boy, what a lousy thing. I mean, this is an issue that we were importantly discussing, and because it wasn't going to be on the Regents, we couldn't discuss it. I am personally responsible for helping drive him out of teaching, by the way. Gordon Law is his name, great man. When I was in undergrad at Cornell, a few years after high school, he shows up as a head librarian at the school I was in, and had a great record of service. But the fact is, here's a young teacher wanting to teach, dedicated, inspirational, but hamstrung by then the Regents. Now, then to evaluate and to tie that to education funding, and that goes along with these so-called competitive grants. Have you heard about those? Do you think you'd get one? Do you think it's worth it? And who do you compete with? I think having incentives makes sense. Having an incentive-based system could work, but not in the context that has been described. And in some cases, those grants that have been competitively driven by the governor in the past still have yet to be even allocated. So that's a system of frustration. With that, I think that it sums up the sentiment of us in the Senate as our priorities to end the tying together, the quid pro quo. You test as an evaluating tool on a system that isn't, as Steve, I, My recall is not that good, but you could call it again. I mean, you can't test without a curriculum, and really to have that so disjointed makes no sense whatsoever. Those are our priorities. Joy, let me turn it over to anybody that has a question, and please just tell me who you are and where you're from. I'd be glad to spend another 5 minutes or so trying to address what's on your mind.
Can I have you go to that microphone? So what we're going to do is we have a microphone over here, microphone one, and then this is going to be microphone two. And we'd like, because we have several panelists who would like to speak, and we'd like you to be able to ask them questions as well, what we're going to ask you to do is if you have a question that is directly tied to something that Senator Nozzolio can control in some way, shape, or form, direct your questions that way. If you have questions that might be better given to a school board member, a parent, a teacher, a student, a school board person, a director of Finger Lakes Community College, or a county supervisor, save those for a little bit later after the panelists. Thank you.
Hi, I'm here as a parent and as an educator, and I've been to a lot of inspiring forums like this, but I'm wondering at what point, you know, there's been this public outcry from parents and educators about the overtesting of our kids, the inequitable funding for our poor districts. Why are we being ignored, and when is it going to change? Like, what else can we do to change how our students?
You thought you'd done a lot, and you have, but you just started. This is not going to be a short road. It's a long road. It's a continual road. It's our responsibilities as citizens to continue along that road. It is certainly important. I didn't hear too many. We've been fighting the sins of the past of 2009, 2010, when the GEA was created in the first place. And Steve talked a little bit about partisanship. I'm going to talk about New York City and the fact that for the first time in our state's history, both houses of the legislature and the governor were from New York City. And what did we get out of that combination? The GEA. Eternal vigilance is the only prescription, and continued work to make forums like this also being involved. It's not a couch potato situation. It's not a short-term process. It's continual.
Good evening. Thank you very much for coming to, tonight. My name is Ken Foster. I am a teacher in the Geneva City School District. My question is, as it stands right now, I believe that the Senate budget still includes the governor's proposal for teacher evaluation, which is hiring outside individuals to come in and look at teachers and to have 50% of the evaluation being done by the test.
Our budget, just let me answer your question or your statement.
And I think
the answer is no, we did not accept Governor Cuomo's recommendation.
Excellent.
Now, and that there is a strong sentiment against, as we are discussing, that we do not confer with it. That means we have our own way, and I think it's very important, that young lady that asked that first question, that your legislators over this critical period of the next 10 days, 11 days, need to hear from you directly. And I know that's what this forum is for, and I would implore you to go back home, and if I'm your legislator, good. If I'm not, then find the one that is, both houses, as well as the governor. And I want to know why Geneva sent all those apples to Governor Cuomo and I didn't even get one of them.
Thank you very much.
The best apples in the state, too, by the way. Keep your voices loudly and now, strongly. That's my recommendation. I don't mean to be, it's not trite at all. It's this is the last few days. And I saw that protest. I drove by and I saw, did I take a wrong turn? I mean, this was Albany again. But that sort of thing is important to make your sentiments heard. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Peter House. I'm an educator and a minister. And so I'm concerned about the privatization and the taxpayer money going to private schools and religious schools. I'm obviously not an anti-religious and anti-private school person, but can you comment at all how you feel about that and how that would affect the Finger Lakes community if we continue to drain taxpayer money to support private and charter schools?
It's, I think, proof positive that the educational system in our Wayne Finger Lakes area is working by the fact that, to my knowledge, there are very few, if any, charter schools. But when you have an attendance rate of under 50%, a graduation rate that hovers around 50% for the city schools, and I'm not talking about Canandaigua, I'm talking about, or even Geneva, I'm talking about New York City, Buffalo, Rochester, especially, that there is a great fear of the children to even go to school. Now, and parents are so much more engaged in charter schools. As a matter of fact, they're part of the enrollment process. I'm not here to defend charter schools. I'm not here to only say that my region, I believe, is proof positive that that's the way you end charter schools is to have the good school systems that we have here that make charter schools something that's not an attractive thing to establish. But there are others who are going to continue to push, particularly as they see the urban, and maybe, Steve, that's the next analysis you could give us. How do you fix the urban problem of a graduation? Now, that's another thing. The governor is using the urban problems and saying that I would bet every school district that's represented here today has a graduation rate of at least 85%, probably closer to 95%. The attendance rate closer to 97%, 98%. That just doesn't happen in those city schools. And I think that's what everybody's looking for, some systemic change there. Thank you for your question.
I'm Donna Arno. I'm a teaching assistant at Wayne Finger Lakes BOCES. So I'm just wondering if there's been any recent studies showing the correlation between the high stakes testing and the any rise in anxiety disorders in our children, because I'm not only here as a teaching assistant, I'm also here as a grandmother, and I'm very worried about my grandchildren.
Well, I think Steve so well put it in his presentation. All those tests, so little time to do anything else, and what product is the result of the test? It's a test to death. I'm not aware of any anxiety. I would defer that question. Maybe Steve and the panel could address that later. If there is, I certainly got anxious at tests when I was a kid, mostly because I was unprepared. But when I was prepared, it was the kind of thing where it seems like more time should be for preparation and less time for evaluation.
Senator Nozzolio. My name is David Sewell. I'm a teacher here in the City School District in Geneva, but I'm also a parent. And tonight you mentioned the idea of incentive programs to help with performance with teachers. I wondered if you could expound on that a little bit.
I may expound on it. I have been in a number of classrooms in the Geneva City School District over time. And let me just point a shout out to one of my favorite teachers is Arlene Eddington. I don't know if she's here. She here? I didn't know you were here. I did not know you were here. This is not a setup. Arlene taught my two nieces. And I'll never forget how the first time I went there, she conducted a political convention. And it was the only time I will ever be nominated for President of the United States. But it was such a great experience for the children, the students, and she went above and beyond to educate them in a great environment. And I remember Arlene coming up to me a few months ago and telling me how perplexed our teachers were because they were being, their creativity, and there's no one with more creativity than her, with all due respect, I know Arlene. Their creativity was being destroyed by this system. That's not right.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's not right. It's not what should happen. It's directly the opposite should happen, and we need to continue making that message known.
My name is Brenda Wren, and I'm from SOTUS. I'm a parent first, but I'm also a fifth grade school teacher, and I have a lot of impact from the state testing, and I see what it does to my students. And so my question is, at a very young age, children are experiencing the stress of high-stakes testing, despite our parents and educators declaring this is just too much. These tests are just one snapshot at assessing students' success, and I'm concerned that they seem to be the only indicator of student proficiency and teacher effectiveness based on our governor's response. What can be done to make our state testing more appropriate for our kids?
I'm going to ask you all to figure that one out. You've got great talent here. You have great leadership. I don't think it should be left to those not schooled professionally in this process. Keep, with all due respect, I love politicians, I am one, but let's keep them out of this process. Whatever, yes, one more.
My name is Heather, and I am a proud teacher and parent in the Penn Yan District. I teach US history, and I teach American government, and I have students very closely following what's going on, and actually one of them took me up on my offer to come tonight to experience civics firsthand. But my question to you is, what do I tell them when they ask me why the governor is trying to do things that the rules say that he can't? Because I don't know what to say.
Well, I think it's a wonderful opportunity to tell your students that we live in a system that doesn't make any governor a king. We have a system that I must say, in defense of the New York State Legislature, who oftentimes is maligned, once in a while you understand it, but the fact is we have a legislature that you elected. Every one of you has the authority to vote and decide who your representatives will be. And your representatives, I mean, if I wasn't here tonight, I would be in Albany. I would have stayed till tomorrow. I'm going back over the weekend. We are working as hard as we can to establish reason and balance and to bring your voice to hear in the state budget process. Tell your students, the founding fathers of this nation put together a system of government that makes sense, and no person is a king. Every citizen serves in the highest public office, and they elect the legislature to act as a check and a balance on those proposals. Ladies and gentlemen, I've stayed long enough. Thank you very, very much.
Thanks so much, Mike, for being here. You know, and the only thing I could say is a late budget be better than a bad budget. I got to tell you, this idea of having outside people come in and evaluate teachers, who are they going to get? I'm not doing it. I mean, who are they going to get? It's really a wild idea, you know. I think the governor should sleep more. Okay. So I'm going to introduce our esteemed panelists right now. And I'm going to introduce them in the order in which they're written here. First, one of my great friends and a person whom I have an incredible degree of admiration, the superintendent of schools of Geneva, Trina Newton. Next, a member of the Seneca County Board of Supervisors, a former Seneca Falls Board of Education member, and the husband of a teacher, Greg Lazzaro. Did Scott Bischoping arrive yet?
He's on his way. Okay. He's about 25 minutes ago.
Next, the Director of Development for Finger Lakes County, Finger Lakes Community College, and I was on the board when we hired her, Amy Pauly. We made good board decisions. Next, a member of the Board of Education, a Penn Yan Mustang, president of the Four County School Boards Association, Kathy Guenther. Next, a reading teacher at the wonderful West Street School, Kathy O'Neill. Next, a parent from Seneca Falls, Kristina Knight. And maybe the smartest person on our panel, a seventh grader from Penn Yan, Jenna Curbeau. So the panelists all are going to make a brief statement, and then when they're done, we're going to have people come up and ask questions, and hopefully we'll bring some logic to this extremely complex issue. So who would like to go first?
Down there. No.
Thank you, Superintendent Newton, for volunteering. Yeah, I didn't tell you. You know, one of my students was Jeff Troutman a long time ago. Jeff Troutman and Joy Martin were both my students. I'm teaching education administration and making union leaders. What's wrong here? Okay. Trina, it's all yours.
Good evening, everyone, and I would like to welcome you to Geneva. I just want you to know that it is an honor to be asked to be up here, and I hope that I do you proud, because this to me is extremely important. Before I start, I just want you to know that I started out as a science teacher in the Geneva City School District, the Geneva Public Schools. Oh, thank you very much. I'm in Geneva now. Does that tell you where I'm at? I started out in the Jamestown Public Schools. Don't tell the folks in Jamestown that I said Geneva. So, and my nearest and dearest friends made a choice. They stayed in the classroom when I made a choice to pursue other endeavors. And we have a promise that if I ever forget where I come from, they need to tell me that I have to remember that I taught in one of the poorest schools in Jamestown with a 92% free and reduced lunch rate. We had the ESL program there, and as a regular ed science teacher, my last year in the classroom, I had 35 classified students in my classes. That didn't include the students who would have been what we would say AIS now. I had many students who were reading on a second grade level in those classes. I didn't become an educator to starve and deprive students of opportunities. And I don't believe that any of you did either. I made a decision to enter the superintendency because I wanted to make a difference for myself and colleagues as a former teacher. I didn't enter the superintendency to cut teachers and programs. I entered the superintendency or administration to create blocks so that teachers could teach and they didn't have to worry about the politics that were taking place at the state and the federal level. And I'll be very honest with you, what's going on right now in the state of New York, I feel helpless. I feel like I can't create those barriers and I can't protect the people that I need to protect. With the GEA and foundation aid, Geneva is owed $61.8 million. Do you know what we could do with $61.8 million? This year alone, if we just have a rollover budget, we just roll the budget over, we're going to be $1.5 million short. And we're being forced to create a budget without anything coming from Albany. They're not telling us that we're going to receive even a dollar more. So as we prepare this budget, I'm looking at all these teachers in the audience today and support staff who are part of the Geneva City Schools. I may have to have a conversation with them that there's a possibility they're not going to have a job next year. And these are kind, caring, dedicated, intelligent educators who put children first. There is a possibility that we're going to have to cut programs. Geneva just received District of Distinction from a national magazine. It wasn't that long ago, and Mr. Baker is here, our high school principal, that our graduation rate was in the low 60s. We're in the 80s. And we've done that as a district, we, the hardworking teachers, our community members, the board members, in spite of all of the unfunded mandates that are being placed on us, and in spite of the money being taken away. And when I speak from Geneva, I speak for all of us. What we have going on in Geneva, we have a large number of ESL students, and we welcome them with open arms. So much so that we decided to create a dual language program, which is an opportunity for all students, not just our ESL students. And we created dual language programs in kindergarten, first grade, and fourth grade for the first time this year. Everyone told us we wouldn't be able to fill those classrooms with English-speaking students. We had wait lists. When I was at the kindergarten orientation last week, so many parents are asking us how they can get their students into either the Mandarin Chinese kindergarten classroom, next year it'll be first grade, or the Spanish-speaking classroom, that we're going to have a lottery. Wouldn't it be a shame if we had to cut those programs because Albany does not feel that what we're doing is important? Wouldn't it be a shame if in Geneva we had to cut our chess team, the extracurricular, for the first time, they just went to the state championships and came in eighth. Wouldn't it be a shame if our masterminds team, which has been invited to the national championships for the second consecutive year, and only 50 small districts get invited every year to the nationals, wouldn't it be a shame if we didn't give our children those opportunities? Wouldn't it be a shame if we had to cut our Latin program in Geneva? We have a strong Latin program with two teachers, and I'm so proud of what they're doing. Wouldn't it be a shame if Arlene Eddington wasn't? I'm sorry that Senator Nozzolio started that, Arlene. She has so much energy, and she spends a lot of time with her students, not only in the classroom, but also after school in our sports program. I mean, I see her. She's the one who sends me emails about the next lacrosse game that's coming up. Wouldn't it be a shame if we had to cut those? I didn't become an educator to punish teachers. I did not enter education so that 50% of an evaluation would be based on a test score. And in Geneva, we have the largest number of parents who choose to opt their children out of the assessments, and that's a parental choice. I'm a little frightened at what's going on. I will tell you, and they know in my district, that I will continue to fight with my last dying breath for public education and for the teachers and the other staff members in this room who dedicate their lives to children. I became an educator to create opportunities, to create dreams and possibilities. Thank you.
Thanks, Trina. Now we'll pass it over to Greg.
Okay. Thank you and good evening. First of all, I have to thank New York State United Teachers for sponsoring this event and for Jeff Trout for asking me. A little history between Jeff and I before I start. I was on the school board who hired Jeff. I was on the school board who gave Jeff tenure. And believe me, I'm a true believer in the tenure system in New York State that we have today. You know, tonight, we're here to discuss some important issues that have been addressed in the governor's budget on education. Number one is educating our children. Number two is state aid to local districts. Number three is education reform and teacher evaluations. The governor's budget proposal is a disservice to all of us in these three areas. While we understand that a common set of standards is a good thing, we also know that in a classroom, teachers teach to all students, and all students are individuals who learn at different rates, and each is at a different developmental level in each class and grade level. A class of 20 to 30 children can be all over the spectrum. And you cannot and should not expect an age group to score on a consistent level if the teachers do not have the tools or resources. And that leads us into the budget of local school districts. Districts need to know what the state aid projections are in order to plan for their local budgets. The governor's budget this year limits school districts, and the GEA gap elimination adjustment over the past 5 years has eliminated many programs, staff, and supplies. How do you reform a system that its own budgeting is eliminating its most important resources in educating our children? How do you reform a system that is moving backwards? Is that reform? Just in the Seneca Falls School District alone, the total aid loss from foundation aid loss and GEA loss since 2010 is $34,594,333, which gets us to the third issue, which is education reform and teacher evaluation. First and foremost, teacher evaluation can and should not be tied to a test score, and you cannot hold us children hostage and tying state budget moves to educational reform. As a former school board member, I understand that education reform and change has always taken place. Blackboards have changed to whiteboards. Laptops have replaced desktops. And instead of rote and memorization, which is the way I learned, children are being taught to think. Technology has changed more in the last 25 years than it did in the first 90 years of the 20th century. Remember, it was only 15 years ago in a presidential race that there was a discussion on who invented the internet. And that is why teachers and other professionals in the educational field need to be in the forefront of any discussion on educational reform, and that is not negotiable. The goal is simple. Give each child the education they need to succeed. Ask our governor to give us our aid and adjust that aid as appropriate. Eliminate the GEA and let them know the reform is only possible when educational professionals are part of that discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Greg. And now Amy Pauley.
So I'm going to take us in a completely different direction and talk about public higher education and what the governor's budget does to your local community college. The promise to community colleges is that a third of our funding will come from the state, a third from a local government, and a third for our students. Currently, the state only provides about 26% of our funding. The local government is slightly less than that, and our students are bearing the burden of the expense of their education at well over 40%. The governor's budget for next year proposes flat funding for community colleges, which means we would get $2,475 from the state for each student at our college. For us, that is actually going to be a decrease in our aid because with a robust economy and the declining numbers of high school students, our enrollment is projected to be down a little bit next year. So we'll actually be taking a budget cut. And as many of you in the room know, your students are coming to Finger Lakes Community College, and they still need the same support and opportunity that they are getting from the local high schools. So we need reading instructors and tutors and counselors and all of the other things that you have at the K-12 level. We need those as well. And we may not be able to fund those types of activities for our students given the current budget situation. And as also many of you know, we are an open access institution, so that means anybody who wants the opportunity for higher education is welcome to come through our doors. And they come with the same challenges that they have in the local school districts, and we're forced to deal with that. In addition, the governor has proposed holding 10% of our aid until the end of the year. Certainly can't budget on that. While he waits to see if he'll approve our performance improvement plans in order to increase access, which clearly not an issue for a community college since we're an open access institution, completion and success. So he would like us to place everyone, transfer, graduate, or into a job. We at Finger Lakes Community have one career counselor for 6,000 students. It may not be possible for us to place every student in another institution of higher education or a career given that situation. In addition, he'd like to tie his approval, his budget director's approval of our curriculum and our program as part of the performance improvement plans, taking some of the control from our local boards. There's a competitive grant proposal. Three community colleges would be able to become community-based centers, and their students would get the childcare and transportation and support systems that they need, and the other 27 community colleges and their students would be left behind. We continuously tell the governor that he certainly can't expect to get tomorrow's results on yesterday's dollar. And we are currently being funded at a level that is lower than where we were in 2006.
See, there's equal opportunity abuse out there. It's not just us. Not just K-12, community colleges, you know, and the old same thing.
And the final is an unfunded mandate that requires us to have every student in every program have an experiential learning opportunity. Well, internships and experiential learning is great and awesome. We have 6,000 students who would need an internship or experiential learning requirement. Many of the students are in liberal arts and sciences programs, and it may not be an appropriate part of their graduation requirement to have an internship. And then, of course, many of our students are juggling family, work, and school, and to ask them to take on this additional burden will certainly hamper their graduation rate and is definitely one of those unfunded mandates.
Thank you. Kathy Guenther.
Good evening. First of all, thanks for organizing this and having everybody here, and including school boards. Sometimes we're not often people think of us as on a school board as being a part of the educational process, but we really are. I'm here actually for Four County School Boards Association, which encompasses Ontario, Yates, Seneca, and Wayne counties. We have, there's 26 schools in the four county area. We have membership of 17 of those schools. And what we do at four counties, we're a not-for-profit membership organization, and we provide programs and services to our membership. We do training, we have information, opportunities to come together and share best practices. We have assistance with advocacy. I just returned with a group of people, and some of them are here tonight. We went to Albany over the weekend to lobby for the same thing we're all talking about here, getting rid of the GEA, which, as Mr. Nozzolio said, yes, the GEA will be gone, but we don't know if that funding will ever be restored. So we'll continue to fight for that. Other things that we have been talking about also is fair funding for all school districts. I think it was Mr. Uebbing said something about what different school districts there are, and you shouldn't have to worry about what zip code you live in to get fair funding. And that's usually what happens. It depends upon your school district, your zip code, and you'll get more money. And we don't have anything much more to cut out. The districts in Fort County are all more dependent on state aid. We're a small, well, Penn Yan is definitely a small rural area. Yates County has 1 in 3 kids living in poverty. And the funding, with the loss of funding, we haven't cut programs yet, but we've cut staff. And the combined wealth ratio average is below, so we have greater losses in this area than most other districts, which that then forces more local property tax, and nobody likes to get property taxes raised. We all know that. Even myself, I do pay taxes like everyone else. And some of the other points that we talked about when we were in Albany was the educator evaluation. We need to leave that with our own school districts. We don't need to have outside people come in and tell us what our people are or are not doing. We have more of an idea ourselves who our people are and how we should evaluate them. Another point that we brought up, and we went through this last year, about charter schools. Charter schools do take away money from our local public schools. There should be a cap on this, on the charter school system, because any child that goes from your district to a charter school, the money goes with them. It doesn't come back. And so you've lost that student, and if the student comes back, you don't get the money back. And we also were, the other points we took up with the representatives were career and technical education and probationary education and tenure awards. These are some of the points we brought up. We met with Mr. Nozzolio and Mr. Kolb, Mr. Oaks, Mr. Funky, Mr. Palmisano, I think that was the ones we met. So that's what I'm here for, and thank you for letting me talk, and I will pass it on to the next person.
From wonderful West Street, Kathy O'Neill.
I'm going to share an experience that we had a few years ago at West Street School. In June, we underwent a rigorous state review, and for the better part of a week, internal and external reviewers conducted an in-depth evaluation of our practices, including Dr. Uebbing over here. They looked at curriculum, current and former lesson plans. They observed each and every teacher, therapist, paraprofessional, counselor, and administrator. They reviewed our systems, our plans, our committees, along with meeting minutes, intervention implementation, fidelity of programming, and RTI processes. They interviewed faculty, staff, administrators, and parents and students across all demographics and accountability groups. They looked at everything, and I mean everything. At the end of this performance review, our school was graded on a rigorous rubric and found to be effective or highly effective in all areas. Then, the state reviewers wrote up a list of recommendations for improvement. Those recommendations focused primarily on our need for additional resources. We needed school social workers, speech and language pathologists, reading specialists, home and school liaisons. But was the state willing to provide the resources? No. And as a reading specialist, I can speak to the literacy needs of our school district. The demand far outweighs the supply. Decades of research show that first grade is a critical time for reading and writing development. 5 years ago, we had 4 reading specialists for first grade alone. Now we have 2. This is unacceptable. On top of limited resources, I've seen the demands of testing increase dramatically. RTI mandates universal screening of all students at least 3 times per year on top of the formative and summative assessments that are conducted by our classroom and special area teachers. We lose 10% of our instructional days to testing every single year. This is wasteful. Before I decided to speak here tonight, I asked myself the age-old questions, is it true? And I believe now is the time to speak our truth. Is it necessary? I fear it could not be more necessary. Is it kind? Our classrooms and communities are built on kindness, but I'm afraid we've been too kind for too long. And finally, I ask, is it an improvement on silence? I also think we've been silent for far too long, and silence is a luxury we can no longer afford. So I'm asking you to speak up, speak out, and opt out. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Kathy. And now, the mother of triplets, Kristina Knight. That got a lot of respect right there, didn't it?
Hello, my name is Kristina Knight, and I'm a single mom to 4-year-old triplets. Governor Cuomo's attack on the education system. Governor Cuomo's attack on the education system touches very close to home to me, as it will negatively impact my children and thousands others just like them for years to come. I would be remiss as their parent if I didn't stand up and fight for their rights to a fair and well-rounded education, since they are obviously the ones who will truly suffer from Governor Cuomo's proposed changes. I felt I needed to give them a voice against the biggest bully out there right now, our own governor of the state. So I wrote a letter to the newspaper, and it was published, and now I'm sitting here before you, giving a voice to those children currently enrolled in school, the children still to come, and parents across this state everywhere. Here is that letter. I am not a teacher. I have never been and never will be a teacher. I have no desire to ever enter that field of work. I cannot even play Candyland with my 4-year-olds without wanting a stiff drink at some point. So I cannot imagine the patience needed to teach a classroom filled with them. No thanks, I'll pass. So knowing this about myself, I cannot even begin to express the gratitude for the fact that there are people out there even crazier than me that actually seek out this profession. Not only do they seek it, but they love it. Fascinating. I am friends with a few teachers, and they all talk of the same things. The true love they have of actually teaching and the pure exhaustion of the bureaucratic bullshit they encounter daily. To do what so many of us will openly admit that we cannot do, and they love it. They would have to, honestly, because why else would anyone willingly be around 12 to 30 kids for 8-plus hours a day? It's certainly not the pay, it's the love. And you know what disheartens me, what I hear and what I see and what I read, is how quickly that love, that light, that passion is being extinguished by our New York State government, AKA Governor Cuomo. He's pretty much been on a warpath against teachers since he came into office, and his latest policy and budget speech was no less insulting to the profession yet again. He would like to implement an evaluation rating system for teachers that would rely 50% of their scores on state tests. Awesome. And by awesome, I mean unbelievably stupid and skewed. I was awful at exams in school. Why? Sometimes I was lazy. Sometimes I had test anxiety. Sometimes I don't know why. But regardless, I sucked at them. Was it my teacher's fault? No. Did I know the material? Yeah. But that wouldn't matter anymore if you go by Cuomo's reasoning. I can just blame it all on the teachers. Where is everyone else's responsibility in this plan? The parents? The students themselves? The administrators? When did it become okay to blame the people trying to do the job and teach the student and yet not point the finger to anyone else? What is this going to do besides encourage teachers to teach to test and not necessarily to learn and retain? Governor Cuomo and any politician that gets behind this latest attack should be ashamed, truly. They're going to do nothing but helping in the aid of the already downward spiral that is the current education system today. Instead of crucifying those on the front lines every damn day, how about they send support and allies and see what happens to those test scores then? Or to quote a close teacher friend of mine, I am lucky to work with the children I work with. I am lucky to do something that I love. I just wish they would get out of my way and let me do it. So to Governor Cuomo and any of his supporters, I say this. Teaching is more than imparting knowledge, it's inspiring change. Learning is more than absorbing facts, it's acquiring understanding. So let them teach. Thank you.
I think that's all we needed. You know, just do that and go home. But now here's somebody who is actually experiencing public education every day. Seventh grader, Penn Yan Mustang, Jenna Curbeau.
Hello, my name is Jenna Curbeau. I'm in seventh grade at Penn Yan Middle School. I play tennis in the fall and basketball in the winter. Last year, I was involved in our building's musical as a sixth grader. And this year, I'm a member of our school's leadership committee. Last year was my first experience with Common Core, and it was quite a struggle. Common Core math was not introduced gradually. Beginning in elementary school and building upon the math skills and topics from year to year, as one might logically think. We jumped right into Common Core math last year, as if we had been working through the modules since kindergarten. But in reality, I felt as if there were gaps in the math I was learning. Sometimes the math wouldn't make sense because we had not been introduced to the Common Core math right from the beginning. Doing math homework is sometimes very frustrating for me. If I need help with my math assignments, I do not feel I could always ask my parents. While they've always been able to answer my questions or help me solve my problems or double check my answers, they can no longer do so unless they know how to do it the Common Core way. There are processes and vocabulary that are new and unfamiliar to my mom and dad, leaving me on my own. In general, I have liked most of the themes and texts we have read in ELA in the last 1.5 years. Some of the texts we read throughout the Common Core modules are new to our school and our teachers. I do not know if my district always has enough money to spend on what it needs, but I do know that my ELA class does not have enough reading materials. My classmates and I share copies of different texts, and if there is only a classroom set of books, we're not able to take the materials out of our classroom. This is inconvenient for me when I want to spend more time reading a text or finishing an assignment. This situation is really difficult for some of my classmates who need extra time to read or complete assignment. They must find time during their school day if they even have time in their schedule because they cannot take the reading materials home with them. If math and ELA classes aren't frustrating enough, the tests I have to take definitely are. I think testing is emphasized too much, starting at too early an age and continuing too often year after year. I think we spend too much time preparing for state tests. The practice and preparation for the state tests seem endless. I know my teachers are tracking my progress and figuring out what skills I need in order to improve my learning, but not many weeks of the school year go by without at least one test. Not everybody takes tests well. It's too bad we have to spend so much time stressing out kids and making them feel as if their success or failure in school depends on a test score. I do not want to be a number to my teachers. I want to be the student who enjoys science or excels at math, and I want my teachers to know that. Someday I want to go to college, especially Syracuse University. I would like my teachers to be able to teach me things that I know will be valuable to me in the future as I strive to be a successful, productive citizen. I also want my teachers to be able to teach what they enjoy and share their excitement about learning, instead of being discouraged by timelines and tests. I've spent a lot of time this evening sharing my feelings with you about testing. Right now, in New York State, all public schools are being tested by the government, and I think the government is currently failing the students, the teachers, our parents, and everybody in our communities. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure President Gearan would like you to think about Hobart and William Smith. And I'd be happy to share with you the nice things about the University of Rochester. So you don't want to go to Syracuse. So one of the hardest working school leaders in this area, the guy that most of you don't know, but he is our BOCES superintendent and a personal friend of mine, Scott Bischoping.
First of all, I'd just like to say I'm sorry that I was late. I was working with one of our other school districts out in Wayne till about 7 o'clock or a little bit after that. But it's great to be here, and it's great to see all of you here. Steve, you know as a superintendent that it's not great to follow a student and a mother of triplets, right? That's not good. Right? You set me up, and I'll remember that. But that was really great. For everybody on the panel, I'm glad I got in here in time for these closing comments. I'm not going to take too much of your time. I just have a couple of things to say. One is that since I've been in education, I've known that our evaluation system is not about just trying to decide a predetermined number of weak teachers. Our evaluation system should be designed to provide improvement for all of us. And so we've always had those kinds of systems in the past. I would hate to see us move to a system that's purely disciplinary instead of about working on improvement. That's the first thing. The second thing is that it's great to see you all here working on the funding and demanding the funding we need to provide education for all of our students. But the reality is, you shouldn't have to be here. That should happen automatically. We as superintendents, some board members, are used to going to Albany to lobby or advocate for the things we need. That's kind of a dance that we do every early spring. But that shouldn't be about teachers, that shouldn't be about students, that shouldn't be about parents trying to work and fight for the tools that we need in order to provide the quality of education to our students. So again, thank you for being here tonight, and thank you for allowing me to speak with you.
So we are now into the Oprah portion of our event. And there's a microphone over there, and there's a microphone right here. And what we're going to do is invite people to come up, and we ask you to address your question to one of our panelists. And we have a district superintendent, we have a superintendent of a district, slight difference, a county supervisor, a community college officer, a board member, a wonderful West Street teacher, a great letter writer, and a student who's going to the University of Rochester. So, just come up and tell me who you want to address your question to.
It's not on.
Hi, my name's Eileen Holling, and I'm on the Geneva School Board, and I've been on it for 6 years. And it's so frustrating to hear, it's so wonderful to see all of you here, but I wish 5 years ago you're all here, because this has been happening. When I got on the school board, I was shocked over changes, because I taught for 35 years, and that's when the evaluation system started. And we had teachers come to the school board and say, this is wrong. This was 5 years ago. What worries me is what's going to happen 2 years from now. Look where we are now. We've had teachers depressed, upset, and they've done it. They still get in those classrooms and do the best they can do. And I'm amazed. I walk through the buildings. And I'm so proud of them, in spite of everything that's happening with this governor. I have observed, because of Hobart William Smith, student teachers in the surrounding area. There's no feeling schools in our districts. There aren't. Yet, with this opting out, all the kids who opt out are the fours and threes. So guess what? We're going to have a lot of failing schools. And you know what? That can happen. The governor can come in and take over your school. Am I right on that? I don't know. They can fire everybody, I guess, and make everybody apply, get rid of the school board. Oh, dear. Get rid of the school board. But so my concern is, and I should be, I don't know who to address. Nozzolio? Who? Where is it going? Where are we going to be in 2 years? This worries me.
Does any one of our panel care to take a whack at that one?
Yes. Some of the comments that Senator Nozzolio made earlier was, it's up to us to make the change when we go to the election booth. I think that Governor Cuomo was supposed to carry the state by a landslide. He only won with 53% of the vote. I think if we had more people come from upstate districts come out to vote, we might have a different governor. And I think that's where change needs to take place. When our elected leaders, and I'm one of them on a county level, does not do the job that you want, when that person is up for re-election, you vote them out and vote someone in who has your value system.
Thank you. Scott, a couple of quick remarks.
Yeah, just a comment. I don't know where, I don't have a crystal ball, so I don't know where things are going to be 2 years from now. But I do know, based on, and I'm not sure if anybody talked about it earlier, so I do apologize in advance, but the new polls that came out from Quinnipiac suggest that the governor's approval rating is falling. And the major reason why his approval rating is falling is because of the handling of education. That's his weakest rating. And his approval ratings say that they would rather, people around the state would rather see the influence of the unions impact education than our governor. Wow. And so if you're asking, that's as good a crystal ball as I can have, is that people around the state, not just you, but everybody else, is saying our governor shouldn't be handling education, at least not the way he's handling it now.
Thank you. Next question or comment?
I'm Gerald Masters, here to make two requests. First, I'm asking panel members as school leaders to publish rejections of Governor Cuomo's education reform proposals. Recent statements by school leaders in Brighton and West Genesee are exemplary documents. I must rely on others for educational leadership, because as reformers have been busy poking their fingers in the eyes of my colleagues and me, we have been busy teaching students. We don't know how education laws get made. We can appreciate the work of Albany bureaucrats and lawmakers who, with no teaching experience, mandate policy. Particularly baffling is Albany's love affair with high-stakes testing. Researchers at the National Education Policy Center know better. Reviewing the last 15 years, they conclude, quote, standardized tests are ineffective and even counterproductive when used to drive educational reform, close quote. There is no research to suppose that high-stakes testing helps students learn. Nevertheless, corporate shills create, sell, pilot, score, and misuse data from irrational testing to gut the bone-wearying work of teachers. Without research or facts, the test industry depends on false promises, advertising, and political campaign contributions. More basically, test-focused educational reforms don't pass our common sense sniff test. Students learn nothing of lasting value from high-stakes tests. Teachers know high-stakes tests steals time from teaching. Taxpayers deserve better than to pay for ineffective and counterproductive testing. A novice teacher 10 years ago, I was assigned to help Dean pass a makeup English Regents exam. I struggled with how to help Dean. I studied a couple of Regents test prep books, but felt uneasy. I decided to take a practice exam and use my test taking to help Dean. A deliberate test taker, I failed. Didn't come close to finishing. I've recovered. However, someone less confident, like Dean, who needed my help, might not. Since then, taxpayers have been billed for new tests that are even more educationally pretentious and less representative of what students have been taught. Test-focused reforms hurt student learning. Governor Cuomo's proposals are misguided. The collective wisdom of many courageous public school advocacy groups is reliable. Panel members, I urge you to listen to us and make your rejections public. However, because well-intentioned supporters of public education will not prevail by merely petitioning politicians, I am making a second, more urgent request of those assembled here. Parents of children in grades 3-8 who will start testing next month, please opt your children out of those tests. Friends of public education, please help those parents. Parents can find the simple steps to opt their children out of testing on the website of the New York State Allies for Public Education. That's www.nysape.org. If enough students refuse to take tests, we may prevail. More likely, we will lose the battle of the next 10 days of political deal-making in Albany. Nevertheless, if we remain resolute in rejecting test-focused reforms and refusing to take those tests, we may yet win the war. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Jerry. We know somebody, we got to talk after this about our common acquaintance. But interestingly, Scott just whispered in my ear, testing is not actually just a state issue, it's a federal issue. And it actually is connected to a race to the top. So let's, we're fortunate to have a representative from Congressman Reed's office here today, and Allison Hunt has agreed to say a few words.
Well, I'll keep my comments brief, as we have a lovely panel here, and I think they did an excellent job articulating the issues that we have with our current education system and what Governor Cuomo envisions for the future, which isn't much of a vision at all. I think we can all agree on that. So I just wanted to touch base. The congressman is standing behind you. For those of you that don't know, we cover 11 counties. The New York 23rd Congressional District ranges from Chautauqua County, Jamestown, where Trina used to work. They're having some issues out there, as Trina knows, all the way over to Owego School District, up to Seneca Falls, and over to Marcus Whitman, where I used to go. I graduated from Marcus Whitman. And some of my teachers will know that some of my subjects I was very strong in, and others I wasn't, and it was not their fault, as all of you can attest to. It's not always your fault that the student doesn't do well in one of your classes. Maybe they just don't do well in the subject. And I give credit to all the teachers that I had. They brought me where I am today. They taught me what I do want to do and maybe what I don't want to do with my future, and that is what's critical about our education system.
The congressman really thinks that this should be a more of a local role with education. As all of you know, Geneva City School District might be different than Marcus Whitman in regards to what their students need. Why do we have to make everybody the same? Why in government do we always feel like everybody has to fit this cookie cutter mold? And we're trying to do it at the federal level, we try to do it at the state level, and our funding depends on that as well, which doesn't help any of you if you don't fit that mold and then your funding gets cut because you can't fit into that mold. So we're just gonna continue to stand with you. Public education is the backbone of our community. I am proud to be a graduate of a high school in Ontario County. And we'll just continue to fight down in DC, continue to advocate, use our voice to advocate in Albany as well. We might not represent you in Albany, but the congressman does correspond with the governor on a regular basis. I don't know if he's listening, but we're gonna keep talking regardless of whether he's listening or not. And the more of you that talk, the better. He can't ignore all of us. Not everybody in this room. Our district director's at a forum in Lansing this evening. He was also in one in Painted Post last week where they had 700 people attend. So people are getting out there. You just gotta keep pushing and it will result in change. So thank you very much.
So actually, I was thinking about APPR and my favorite candidate was superintendent standing in the back. And when we were in the 90s and early 2000s, we had this incredible teacher evaluation system. It was all about individual personal growth. And it was about conversations and deep introspection and looking at your practice and seeing how can you improve that. And that was all dashed away, by another mechanical system that so far, well, hasn't worked very well. So I'm sorry for that. Do you guys want to comment? I'm sorry, you're supposed to be the panelist, not me. Do you want to comment on any of the comments so far?
No, you're doing a great job.
Yeah.
Again, I'm going to talk about our bad governor. And I thought only good students got apples. But Governor Cuomo is handling this budget crisis like a bad labor management process. If you were ever in a union, you'd know what I mean. It's a negotiation with him, and he's not going to discuss, and he's not going to converse. It's what he wants. And I think that's the wrong way to deal with our teachers. NYSUD had their emblem up here, and I think it said it all. It said, respect public education and respect teachers. So I think that's the message that Governor Cuomo has to hear. He's not an educator, and he shouldn't be making those decisions for educators.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Jackie Lakins. I'm a proud graduate of Geneva High School in 1994. I was in Mrs. Holling's fifth grade class. I moved away for 20 years, lived in a couple different states, most recently in Oklahoma, where education is in real danger. 4 years ago, my husband and I chose to move back here for a lot of reasons, but one was for the education that I got, because I'm proud of the education I got, and it has served me very well. Mrs. Holling pointed out that this has been a problem for more than 5 years, though. And it really only came to my attention in the last couple years because I have three elementary students. And what I'm finding is that the Common Core curriculum and the testing is failing my three kids in three different ways. And my biggest concern here is it seems like this movement, all of you here today, really took shape and took power when it became about teacher evaluations. That's when people really got in an uproar. And so my fear is, and my question maybe for those of you in the union, is if the teacher evaluation piece gets taken off the table, does that mean that we're done fighting for our kids?
No. any comments from the panel? Okay, go ahead.
Hi, thank you everyone for coming. I'm so glad to see so many people here.
My name is Michelle Earl, and I've been fighting this for about 2.5 years as a parent, a guardian. I have been so concerned about Common Core and everything that's been going on. Allison, I'm glad you got here. Thank you. We got to meet with Congressman Reed the other day and talk about these issues. There are so many issues here that we are all concerned about. High-stakes testing. We all agree that is the worst possible thing we could do to our children. We also know that the high-stakes testing is tied directly to the Common Core. I am vehemently opposed. I am vehemently opposed to Governor Cuomo, what he's doing to the state. What I want to know is that because we know the testing is based on Common Core, the Common Core, which comes down, it's top-down. You talked about it being federal. It's based on a curriculum, and it's associated. It's all de facto, top-down, federal, unfunded mandates, per No Child Left Behind, race to the top. We know that's all ending this year, so I don't know where the rest of the money's coming from, but they're pushing it down the pike. I'm so glad to hear a student talk. I was amazed to hear what you had to say. I'm glad I'm not the only mom out there. I've been feeling alone in this community, and to see this room with this many people in it, it just touches my heart. I am so glad that the teachers and parents in this community are finally saying, we're done, we're not gonna do this anymore. It's over. Cuomo's, he's got to release the money for our schools. It's all based on the frameworks that are coming down. What I would prefer and what I wanna know from the Board of Education and the people that are representing us at our local school levels, because it's all based on Common Core, do we prefer moving ahead with that when we get our funding, which we will, or are we going to go back to a locally teacher-educated, corroborating, and let you guys do your jobs? Isn't that really what we want? I want my teachers to do for my eighth grade student and for my grandchildren what you've done so well for so long. I've never seen so many problems in a couple of years. As a mom, I was happy being at home doing what I was doing as a mom. I spend more time in Albany lobbying legislators, and I don't even know what I'm doing. I've been reading bills. I have learned how to go through the budget. I've learned how to identify what is missing in my school in the millions and millions and millions of dollars. Yet our teachers are doing everything that they can possibly do. We have amazing teachers. I'm in Seneca Falls. Our school district is amazing. My teacher, there they are. I'm glad you guys are here. We know that it's not a one size fits all. I also want to know from the Board of Education, are you going to get on board with telling parents that they can opt out? I want a letter sent out to all of the parents saying, you know what? You have the right to refuse. For parents that are here in the audience, I have blank letters if you need them. I have a lot more to say, but I'm gonna leave it there. If you want opt-outs and refusal letters or anything along those lines, my name's Michelle Earl. I'm in Seneca Falls, and believe me, I got the background. I could talk for 45 minutes.
Are there anybody on the panel who'd like to take a whack at that one? Well, obviously it's 9 o'clock, and you notice, I think we'll take two more comments, okay? And then we're gonna, I'll make a few closing comments, and then we'll send you home. And hopefully this will be, we can have a call to action. So two more comments.
Hi, everyone. Yeah. Thanks for being up here. I had not planned on asking a question, but as I sit there, I feel sometimes the need come over me. I'm Brian Askin. I live in Geneva. I have two students within the district. I also am a first grade teacher in Lyons, which in many ways is a microcosm of Geneva with similar social issues that we have going on in the student level. I hear the talk about Common Core, and to me the Common Core isn't the issue as much as our full acceptance of the modules. And I know that the parent that had spoken earlier who had said that it was the testing that we got on board with. What people don't see is the advocacy we do within the classroom and trying to work with the curriculum that we've been asked or told to teach. And I guess my question would be to the district superintendents, why have we blindly just taken, I know it's a free curriculum because I go on Engage New York all the time, but why have we accepted this curriculum without looking at it further and seeing if it really makes sense? Because I have students, when I send homework home, their parents in first grade are telling me they can't figure out how to do it. And I got kids who barely know their number sense. What comes before 39? 48? And when we start off teaching number bonds and algebra and word problems that the kids are still at reading level 3, and these word problems are probably at a reading level 16. I guess, and not to put you on the spot, but why have all these districts accepted these modules as the curriculum? That's what I can't figure out.
Thank you, Brian. Okay, Scott, you were kind of pointed on that one, and Kathy, you can follow up.
So you didn't want to put me on the spot, though, right?
First, we're going to have the letter writer and the student read, and then your turn.
Oh, no. Then I'm on the spot. Yeah. Well, we all know in the first place that the implementation of the Common Core state standards was flawed. I think nobody here would disagree that it was rushed and it was done poorly. So given that, districts are required to have a curriculum in place. And most districts, especially our districts, don't have the resources to put together their own curriculum. And so they relied on the state curriculum, which is available through the modules. That's to answer your question as to why districts would do that. I think now most of our districts are looking at how to adapt those modules so that they can deal with the things that you were talking about, the different differentiated needs for students. I think also as teachers, like any other change that we've had in curriculum, whether local or due to a change in state standards, teachers become better and better over time. The more time they've used it, the more professional development they get. And so however that progresses, you all will continue to improve like you have over the last few years in terms of how you've used the new standards. I hope I answered your question.
You answered it, but it's, I guess from the classroom perspective, it's a flawed, for me it's a flawed curriculum from the outset.
Well, I was going to say when we went to Albany, one of the another point that we brought up was schools need funding to train the teachers instead of the schools taking money that we don't have to train the teachers to do this curriculum. As Scott said, the rollout was bad. I mean, they just sort of laid it on us and said, here, do it. And everybody went, what? So, as that perspective, schools don't have the money to train the faculty to teach these standards.
Kathy?
I'm just proud to say that West Street School did not adopt the ELA curriculum. The teachers developed their own, and they're awesome. And we will share if anyone else wants them. We will share, and you can use them, so don't accept that as an excuse from your administrators that there's nothing out there, because we will share.
Yeah, Penn Yan also did the same thing. We adapted. We didn't adopt. We didn't adopt. We adapted. So, yes. Oh, yes.
One comment?
There's a comment here. Go ahead.
Okay. The comment I had is Dr. Uebbing earlier today said was in his 60s and he was demonstrating. And I always say one person is a philosophy. This many people is a movement. So continue to go to Albany, continue to write your letters, and perhaps things will change. I have hope they will when I see this many people out.
My name is Amber Snyder, and I go to the high school of Penn Yan Academy, but I also go to the Stanley BOCES program, Education Professions, and my English teacher is sitting here with us, but he helped us write an educational letter to Governor Cuomo, but I don't think my question is going to be answered, so I'm going to ask you guys. I had asked him why he thinks it's, like, I don't know where he got the idea to come into, like, the educational world and change the education needs for the students and stuff. So I just don't understand
where he got the idea.
Where do you think? What do you think, guys? Where do you come up with this idea? Who wants to answer that? I'm going to call on Jenna. Jenna, where do you think the governor came up with this idea to be an educational expert? And she's going to the University of Rochester, so. Anybody want to take a whack at where you come up with this? Go ahead.
It's because he went to school.
Because he went to law school, took the bar exam like four times. Yeah.
Sometimes I think Governor Cuomo is certifiable, so.
Yeah. Well, the problem is he is the governor, you see. He is the governor, and we, not meaning me and you, but we elected him. And so now we have to give him guidance as to what we want. You have to understand that. We have to give him guidance to what we want. One more comment, and then I'm going to close. We'll all go home and think about this.
I promise I'll be short, because I know there's Scandal fans out there, and I know you want to get home and watch it if you haven't DVR'd it. Anyways, if you didn't know, I'm Arlene Eddington. I'm from the Geneva City School District. And I do coach lacrosse, as Trina said. But if you don't know me, I'm usually everybody's biggest cheerleader. And I'm usually pushing everybody, yeah, go, go, go. But you know what? I'm not a cheerleader or a fan of Cuomo. No way am I one of his fans or his cheerleaders. He's done too much to education and our kids for me to be one of his fans. He's got a lot of changing to do. I'm just gonna end with this. One of my favorite movies is The Rocky. Rocky was an underdog, and I think of us teachers as underdogs. We've gotta take up this fight, we've gotta fight the fight, and we've gotta be champions for our kids. If we do it, we all stay together, we're gonna prevail, and he's going down.
Dun, 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 dun.
Steve,
so, you know, I'm going to go back to
Steve,
something.
Can we just get this one last patient person? And if everybody would just hang for like two more minutes, we will get you out of here. We have some information for you. So if you would share your microphone, Dr. Uebbing.
My name is Sarah Carey, and I'm a high school art teacher at Waterloo High School. I have a question regarding curriculum. Our district has put many years, many hours into writing curriculum through Silver and Strong, through the top 10 steps to implement into our curriculum. We've spent dozens upon dozens of hours over the last decade. I work off of those 10 steps. I love Silver and Strong. I use those strategies every day in my curriculum. What is wrong with those? And I can attest that most of my colleagues here, and maybe many of the other districts, my former principal is sitting right over there, Jeremy Klingerman. I can rattle it all off right up here. What's wrong with that curriculum? We were given time, and then we were told to write our maps, our curriculum maps, and I know Geneva did, I know Seneca Falls did, I know it came through BOCES. I would love to have an understanding because I'm passionate about that curriculum.
Anybody? Anybody? Remember the movie Teacher? Anybody? Anybody?
Well, no. I guess.
Anybody?
Do you want me to? Richard Strong is, and God rest his soul, because he passed away a couple years ago. And any teacher in the state who was lucky enough to work with Silver and Strong, especially Richard Strong, came out of it stronger on the other side. And there is absolutely nothing wrong with the curriculums that were written by teachers. I think that we're in a place today where there was a national movement, and what was happening in New York State wasn't happening in every state. And governors got together a number of years ago and felt that there needed to be a common curriculum in order for us to compete globally. I'm not saying it's right, I'm not saying it's wrong. And unfortunately, we threw out the baby with the bathwater. And I am sorry for that. For many districts, it does need to come back. And for other districts, they didn't have the same experience you had with Richard Strong.
Okay, so for those of you who have hung out through all of this tonight, my hat is off to you. Would you give yourselves a hand for being here? Next, I would like to thank our panelists, and I'm going to let them get out of the spotlight, but give them a huge hand. Don't run away yet. I have a call to action for you. Out on those tables, there are all kinds of things. First and foremost, if you are a teacher and you have not seen this postcard yet, please fill it out. There's a box on the table. You fill it out, you say where you are from, and invite the governor to come to your classroom to see that our schools are not failing. Next, if you're anybody connected to public education, fill out this postcard. Put your name at the top and on the bottom and where you live somewhere, and we'll figure out. There are labels at the back for each of your legislators if you live in this region. If you don't, you can take it home with you, and this will tell you who your legislators are, but don't leave them hanging. They need your back. Cuomo has been a bully to all of the legislature, but if all of you show up with your legislators on Cuomo's doorstep, like we're doing tomorrow, will we take those apples to Cuomo tomorrow? We're taking them to him. If you follow behind your legislators and call with his blue sheet, that will make a difference. This is really important to whomever you speak. The one that says Cuomo owes kids $759 million, find your district on there and tell your legislators this is how much your district is owed. It's your money and you should be getting it. It should be for your children. This is just real quickly, Senator Nozzolio's gap elimination bill. Read it and tell Cuomo we need to take care of it. Then, if you want some help talking to a state senator or a legislator, this is a help wanted ad, and it gives you some talking points. Then there's the myth versus reality. Most of what Governor Cuomo is saying to you as educators and to parents and students and community members are myths. Read the facts. There are 12 things you can do to fight back on this yellow sheet. So some of you may not feel like talking to a legislator, but you can certainly find a way to tell somebody to do something. Last but not least, you can go to the NYSET Action Member Action Center, and you can click in. And even as a community member, you can find a way in. And we have all kinds of letters. You can send faxes to the governor. You can send faxes to your legislators. This is a call to action. You came here. You picketed out front. I'm sorry I missed it. I was in here. But the power that was in this room and still in this room, carry that forward. Take it. Respect public education. It works. Thank you.